My problem.
Dragging.
Forgiveness is essential to our relationships. An inescapable fact of our human condition is that we are bound to hurt others, and others are bound to hurt us. If we are to live in freedom and joy, we must learn to say six words: I am sorry, and I forgive you. In the beginning of a new year, let us work at our relationship with God, spouses, our partners, family members, and others in our lives. We can receive healing through the act of asking for and extending forgiveness.
Good morning to all of you. You're looking mighty fine this morning. And we have children today. Yay! In your bulletin today, you should have received two things. Today we're looking, we're continuing with our DVD series on forgiveness using Reverend Adam Hamilton's DVD and book study. But you should, so week one we looked at personal forgiveness, the things that we need to take to God and receive God's grace for. And then last week we looked at relationships, particularly relationships that are close to us, but all relationships, and how we can make them better. Today, we're answering the question that I've actually been asked by some of you. How many times do I have to forgive somebody? So we're looking at that today. We're looking at Jesus's response to Paul, to Peter asking him that question. How many times do we need to forgive somebody? The last time time somebody asked me that question, and it was somebody from the congregation. And they had been hurt deeply by a family member, but I was able to answer them. How many times has Jesus already forgiven you? So how many times do we have to forgive one another? So you received an insert called Jesus Is Counting. It's got our scripture on one side, and then this little Jesus Isn't Counting. And we all say, praise God, that Jesus is not counting the times that we need to be forgiven. The other thing in your bulletin this morning is a little pink slip concerning Ash Wednesday communion service. Please fill this out. You don't need to sign it. But at the end of the service today, if you would just hand it to me at the door, then this will determine whether there will be an Ash Wednesday communion service, and if so, which one of the facilities it will be in. So I need your input on those things. We also want to say a big thank you to Sandy Hum, who is playing at both churches today and next week, so that Christy could get some time away. It's Ernie's second birthday, so she wanted to be with her family, and we don't blame her for that. That's a great thing to do. The healthcare team is looking after you today. Please visit them in the chapel after the service today. This is the first Sunday of the month, and so we're celebrating Holy Communion this morning. Remember, in the United Methodist Church, that all are welcome at the Lord's table. Jesus is our host. You don't need to be a member of this nor any church. We just hope that you have a desire in your heart to have a closer personal relationship with your Lord and Savior. So all are welcome here. And with that, I've got one other thing to ask you, just to call out. What are some of your petty annoyances? You shouldn't have to think very long. What annoys you?
Taxes.
Our problem.
Taxes.
What else?
Slow checkout.
What?
Slow checkout.
Slow checkouts. What else?
Phone calls.
Phone calls.
Spam.
Spam. What else? Oh, Reese, what annoys you?
When I'm not getting a
birthday. Oh. There's a children's message in that, and you know what it is, right? If the dog annoys you when you're not listening, what about when you're not listening to mom and dad or grandma or the teacher? There's a great message there. What else is annoying to you? Yes, Josh.
People acting like they're better than others.
All right. That's another good one. Yes.
What are shirts?
Yes. Made out of wool, right? Anything else? Yes.
Larry. Inconsiderate drivers on the road.
Inconsiderate drivers. Sometimes that's ourselves, isn't it?
I always have one.
What?
Okay. Mr. Isaac.
All right, Isaac. Again, things that annoy us are probably things we're also doing, right? Oh my gosh. But we're going to come back to those petty annoyances at the end of the service today. But just keep thinking about that. How many times do we need to forgive ourselves and others around us and even the stranger? Let's look at some highlights for the week ahead. Yaha is this Thursday at noon. There's a wonderful meal being planned and an activity. And so if you're available, come and join us for Yaha. We do ask you to sign up so that we know how many people are coming. That's really helpful. Next Tuesday, not this Tuesday, but next Tuesday, the United Leadership Team meets for the first time. If you have anything that's concerning or questions that you might have, please write those down and get them to Larry Arthur by next Sunday so that we can add those to the agenda. And you can read the rest of the highlights for yourself. With that, I'll go back to Ms. Edith.
Please stand as you were able for our call to worship. In the darkest valley,
at the banquet table,
in the hard work of life,
at the moments of ease,
in our day-to-day reality,
at times set aside,
like this time, now,
for worship, for listening, for paying attention,
with every step we take,
goodness and mercy follow us,
our cups overflow. Please remain standing for our hymn of praise, Freely, in the hymnal on 389 above the screen.
But forgiveness is in you. That's why we are here this day in worship to honor you. I hope, Lord, I pray, Lord, my whole being hopes. And I wait for God's promises. Psalm 130. And all God's people said, Amen. Please be seated. Another thing we have to do. Another thing we've been doing during this short sermon series is what I call visualized prayer. It's a form of prayer where you put yourself into kind of a visual place where you can find yourself. Find the answers to your questions or lessen your anxiety or your anger. So we'll be doing that again this morning in just a few minutes. On your prayer list today, I'll just update you. Bob Edgar's procedure went very well this week. He's home and beginning that healing process. He'll have to have something more done in a little bit, but things went well. So pray for both Jim and Bob. And Ginger Vetter is doing well at home. She's ready for a few visitors here and there for short visits. She might need a little bit of help here, and therefore it will be months before she's able to return to us. But she's ahead of schedule on everything with their open heart surgery. So give her a call, write her a card or a note, call and see if there's something you could help her out with, and that would be very, very helpful. Now let's again, I don't usually ask people to close their eyes and fold their hands, but in visualized prayer, it's helpful just for us to get ourselves centered. So I will ask you just to close your eyes and bow your head a little bit. I'm so, so angry, Lord. It's happened once again, and again, and again. Why, Lord? Why does this person in my life continue to do this action and say these words that cut so deep into my soul? I find it so difficult to forgive and to forget. And I'm so tired of all of it. It's weighed so heavily on me. I feel like I'm carrying around such a big weight. Even some days I feel like I'm carrying the wooden cross that Jesus was nailed to. I keep coming to you. I keep giving this back to you. And I feel like I've gotten to a place where I can forgive and forget. And then it happens again. How long, Lord? How many times, Lord, will I have to endure this? And then I remember that when Jesus was hanging on that cross, he was dying for me. And I, through my own sins, my own actions and words, helped to nail him to that cross. And as I look at him, as I stand at the base of the cross and look up into his face, he doesn't have to say anything. He just looks into my eyes. I know what he's saying. Billy Lou. Mary. Joe. Helen. Ron. I'm here on this cross for you. You're asking how many times you need to forgive. And I'm telling you over and over again that is how many times I've forgiven you. I don't even count them. I'm not keeping a checklist. And I'm asking you to do the same for those that offend and hurt you. You will be better off when you are able to forgive. And yes, there are things that you're not able to forget. I realize that. But forgive. Forgive in my name as you have been forgiven. And all God's people said, Amen. 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 loves me is the kids come forward for just a couple of minutes with me. Mistake on a math problem? On a quiz? Mm-hmm. Yeah, for a spelling word or something like that? Mm. Multiplication problems, that's right. So we all have mistakes during the week. And sometimes, like when you're in school, you can take your pencil and erase it, right? So sometimes we need a great big eraser. Great big one. I don't know if you can see these closely, but there's something wrong with this group of pencils. Can you tell what it is? There's no eraser left. Oh my gosh. How am I going to erase my mistakes? Well, that's what we're talking about right now, is how do we make up for the things that we do wrong? On a test or a quiz or even on just a homework page, we can erase it and try again. And we can also ask Jesus to come and be our eraser and erase the big mistakes that we make in life. We're always going to say things and we're going to do things that hurt other people. And other people are always going to do things that hurt us as well. But by asking Jesus to come into our life, to be our Lord and Savior, He continues to teach us. He speaks to us. He says, you know you shouldn't have done that. You know you shouldn't have said that. So go to that person and tell them that you're sorry. And hopefully they will say back to you, I forgive you. Or some other kind word. We do those things all the time, but Jesus is always with us, always speaking to us about what we should and should not be doing in all of our lives. Little kids, children, youth, adults. It's the same story for all of us. Ask Jesus into your heart. He'll be right there with you. To keep reminding you of the ways that we should live and should go. I hope that we have a better week ahead of us as we remember to seek forgiveness and to give other people forgiveness as well. Got a bag for you as you go off to junior church or the nursery, and we're going to be singing verse 2 as they go.
Lesson today comes from Matthew 18, 21 through 35. Then Peter said to Jesus, Lord, how many times should I forgive my brother or sister who sins against me? Should I forgive as many as seven times? Jesus said, not just seven times, but rather as many as 77 times. Therefore, the kingdom of heaven is like a king who wanted to settle accounts with his servants. When he began to settle accounts, they brought to him a servant who owed him 10,000 bags of gold. Because the servant did not have enough to pay it back, the master ordered that he should be sold, along with his wife and children and everything he had, and that the proceeds should be used as payment. But the servant fell down and kneeled before him and said, "Please, be patient with me, and I'll pay you back." The master had compassion on that servant, released him, and forgave the loan. When that servant went out, he found one of his fellow servants who owed him 100 coins. He grabbed him around the throat and said, "Pay me back what you owe me." Then his fellow servant fell down and begged him, "Be patient with me, and I'll pay you back." But he refused. Instead, he threw him into prison until he paid back his debt. When his fellow servants saw what had happened, they were deeply offended. They came and told their master all that had happened. His master called the first servant and said, "You wicked servant, I forgave you all that debt because you appealed to me. Shouldn't you also have mercy on your fellow servant as I have had mercy on you?" His master was furious and handed him over to the guard responsible for punishing prisoners until he had paid the whole debt. My Heavenly Father will also do the same to you if you don't forgive your brother or sister from the heart. Our hymn of preparation is "Forgive Our Sins as We Forgive" in United Methodist Hymnal on 390 or on the screen.
I'm going to be singing this. To the tune of "Amazing Grace," but I do hope that you pay attention to these words.
is something that you know intuitively, but most recently there have been actual medical studies done that indicated to us that our unwillingness to forgive, when we hold on to resentment and bitterness and hate and anger, it has a negative impact on our bodies. I mean, physiologically, it harms us. It, of course, harms us also when it comes to our spiritual lives and our emotional lives, our relationships. But physically, when we hold on to bitterness and hate and anger and resentment, we find that stress is increased in our lives. The brain produces more of certain chemicals that it's not meant to produce on a regular basis or an ongoing basis. We find that has an impact on our cardiovascular systems. It affects our physiology, our muscular system. There's a whole host of ways. It gives us ulcers, and a whole host of ways that physically we are harmed by this. Our lives are shortened by holding on to resentment and pain, bitterness and hate and heartbreak. Which is why I think James says, confess your sins to one another and pray for one another so that you may be healed. That passage of scripture is found in the context of discussions James is having about physical healing in our bodies. And he's saying one way that you find healing physically is when you confess to somebody that you've wronged and you ask for forgiveness from them. Because when you're in the place where you're the one who's done the wrong, you also find this physiologically harms you. And you bring healing to the person that you've harmed. So in every way, forgiveness is an essential part of health in our lives, both physically, emotionally, and spiritually. Now, during this series of sermons, we've used stones as a metaphor for the wounds that we've inflicted on others and that others have inflicted upon us. And we've talked about small stones, medium, and large stones. And today, I'm going to introduce you to the jumbo stone. That is the colossal and just overwhelming, crushing wounds that sometimes we've inflicted on others, sometimes they've inflicted upon us. And my hope is most of you have never experienced one of those kinds of painful wounds, but if you have, part of this message is going to be for you today. And so we're going to consider these things, and we're going to understand how we go about forgiving and how we access forgiveness. Now let's think about that in terms of these small rocks. I think it was these kinds of things that Jesus had in mind when Peter approaches him in Matthew chapter 18, and he says this. He says, "Lord, if another member of the church sins against me, how many times do I have to forgive them, Jesus? Is seven times enough?" And Jesus says to him, "Not seven times, but I tell you, 77 times." Or you'll see in the footnote in your Bible, 70 times seven times. To forgive is to decide, to make the decision that you are not going to seek redress for the wrong. You're not going to seek to get even with the person or seek justice. You are going to let it go. Now, the smaller stones, you know, we don't really need to have that practice of repentance happen. It's nice when it happens, it's helpful, but it's not essential with the small things. But when it comes to the medium and large stones, that's kind of important in this process. So if somebody doesn't repent, do we not forgive them? Well, let me mention that there's two sides to forgiveness, two senses in which we might talk about the forgiveness that we offer to someone else. The first is what happens in here, and the second is what we give to you as a gift. Now, when it comes to what happens in here, if I don't forgive, I'm still carrying this. Forgiveness is for me. It's to help me let go of these things so that I don't poison myself or continue to carry these stones in my soul. I need forgiveness. I need to know how to let go of those things. Otherwise, I'm going to be hunched over and in pain for the rest of my life. So to be mentally, physically, spiritually, emotionally healthy, I have to learn how to forgive. I have to let go. Now, when it comes to you knowing about that forgiveness and my releasing you from the obligation or the right of retribution or just restoring our relationship, I may not need to do that as I forgive you without you repenting. So let's just ponder that for a moment. Now, there are situations in which our giving mercy to someone who hasn't asked for mercy actually hinders their redemption. I'll give you one example. I preached on it back in 1997. December of 1997, 14-year-old Michael Carneal opened fire on a group of students, his fellow students, at Heath High School of Paducah, Kentucky. These kids were having a prayer meeting. He showed up with a gun. He began shooting. He killed three kids, and he left four others wounded. Now, the national spotlight, all of the media, was on Paducah, Kentucky, and Heath High School, and on these kids who were at this prayer meeting. And the kids were Christians, and they were trying to do the Christian thing, and what they thought the Christian thing to do was to forgive Michael. He had just been arrested. I mean, this is like the next day. And they make up signs. They made up a sign. Maybe you remember this. And it said, "Michael, we forgive you." Now, first is the question, were they the ones to forgive, or should that have been the job of parents? But the second question is, was offering mercy that way, was that actually helpful to Michael Carneal's soul? Or is it possible that that was harmful? You see, when you offer, when those kids, and they were going to take a lot longer than one day to have to heal from this. They weren't going to let go of that in one day. They weren't ready yet themselves to offer forgiveness. But even if they had been, when you offer mercy to somebody who doesn't yet get that they did something wrong, sometimes that helps them see that what they did was not a big deal. It was not such a bad thing that I did, because they gave me mercy within 24 hours. So redemption sometimes helps people feel the wall between us, or the gap that they erected before we offer them mercy. Not always, sometimes. I'll give you another example. This week I was at a domestic violence workshop, and there are many times where men or women physically abuse their partners. Most often it's men. The man beats the woman up, and then he feels terrible remorse, and he apologizes, and he says how sorry he is, and he'll never do it again. And then she takes him back. She says, "Okay, I love you, and I'll take you back, and I forgive you, but you better never do that again." But then he does it again. And then she takes him back again, and he does it again, and she takes him back again. And then after a while, the mercy that's flowing without change, that last component of repentance, when that mercy's flowing that way, what happens is the person who is the victim of the abuse becomes the enabler of more abuse. The person who's abusing is convinced that I can do this as many times as I wish, and she's always going to take me back. And there's a place in which our giving mercy is no longer the Christian thing to do, because the Christian thing to do is to try to help this person find redemption, not to enable them to continue to be the thing, the monster that they have been. Now, in the days of Moses really gave us a way of dealing with wrongdoing. We talk about it as the lex talionis. It's not just found in the Old Testament, it's found in other religions. But the lex talionis is the law of retaliation. It was designed to stop retribution from getting out of hand. So in Moses' day, 1200 BC, if you cause me to go blind in my eye, if I lose my eye because of you, you lose your head because of that. My eye is gone, your head is gone. You see how retribution worked? So lex talionis said, no, all you can do is take out their eye. So you cause me to go blind, I'm going to cause you to go blind, and then we're square, right? So that's what the world offers. We see this between the Palestinians and Israelis. We see it in the Congo. We saw it in Rwanda. It's you do, I'm going to do back to you. This doesn't work. It doesn't work. It doesn't bring healing. You may feel better for a little while, but you're not going to find your soul redeemed by this. You're not going to find your heart lifted by this. You're not going to find the other person redeemed by this, because they're just going to get mad and throw another stone or two in your backpack. And that's how it works in the world, which is why we have wars, which is why we have suffering in our world in so many places. It's the law of retaliation, and Jesus says it has to stop. And so what he offers us is the alternative, and that is grace. That is that we learn to forgive and let go of the pain. And that may take a long time. And we have to do it again and again and again. So we remember our own shortcomings. We try to assume the best of the other person. We pray for them regularly. And then eventually we find we let go. Forgiveness doesn't come easy. And sometimes when they're big stones like this, this is every day, it's that prayer. And we just chip away at it. A little bit at a time. God, please deliver and save me from this resentment. Please transform the life of the one who wronged me. And set me free. That's the time for your business.
Remind ourselves that this is an old
series. In the 1990s, I think, 1996, 1997, 1998, somewhere in there. And yet, he has this reference to things still going on in our world today. The same places, the same people, the same issues. But then if we look at our own lives, we may say the same thing. Why do I have the same issues going on in my life that were going on 20 years ago? Why haven't I been able to give that thing, that stone that I'm carrying around, why haven't I been able to give it to the Lord and leave it? Good life lessons for us, especially as we prepare our hearts to come to the Lord's table today. It's a place where we can take things that we need. Place where we can take the issues in our life and give them to Jesus. Let's do just that. Let's prepare our hearts for communion. Turn in your hymnal to page 12 for me. On page 12 of the invitation, and then I'll ask you to join me on the confession and pardon. Christ our Lord invites to his table all who love him, who earnestly repent of their sin and seek to live in peace and shalom with one another. Therefore, let us confess our sin before God and one another. Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbors. And we have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray. Free us for joyful obedience through Jesus Christ our Lord. Take your own needs to the Lord in prayer for just the next few seconds. Family of God called Breckenridge, hear our good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners, which proves God's love for each of us. In the name of Jesus, our Christ, you are forgiven.
In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
Glory to God. Amen. And now I'll ask you to turn to page 13 for the great Thanksgiving. Actually, to page 15, I'm sorry. Turn the page over, just a couple pages. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Almighty God, Creator of heaven and earth. Before before the mountains were brought forth, you formed the earth. From everlasting to everlasting, you alone are God. You created light out of darkness and brought forth life in the earth. You formed us in your image and breathed into us the breath of life, your breath, your ruach. And we turned away and our love failed. You remained steadfast. You delivered us from captivity, made covenant to be our sovereign God, and spoke to us through your prophets. And so, with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn.
Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus our Christ, our Savior, in whom you have revealed yourself. He is our light and our salvation. In Jesus' baptism and in table fellowship, Jesus took his place with sinners. Your Spirit anointed him to preach good news to the poor, to proclaim release to the captives and recovering of sight to the blind. Jesus set at liberty those who are oppressed, and Jesus came to announce that the time had come when you would save your people. By the baptism of Jesus' suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. On the night in which Jesus gave himself up for us, he took bread, he gave thanks to you, he broke that bread, giving it to those who had been with him in the upper room for that Passover Seder meal, saying to them, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When the supper was over, that Passover Seder, Jesus took a cup of wine that was left from the supper. Again, he asked God to bless it, and he gave it to those gathered, saying, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant. It's poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus our Christ, today we offer ourselves an offer in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and a living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of our faith.
Christ is alive. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
Pour out your Holy Spirit on all that have gathered here, brothers and sisters around the world. Pour out your Spirit on these gifts of bread and juice. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes again, and he will. This time in final victory, and we are invited to feast at his banquet once again. May we be, for the world, the body of Christ redeemed by his blood. Through your Son, Jesus our Christ, with the Holy Spirit and your Holy Church, all glory and honor is always yours, Almighty God, now and forever. Amen. Join me in saying the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth.
present. We are asking you to come forward. There's the offering plate for your offering, if you have one on this day. We're so grateful for all of your gifts of time, talent, and treasure. They are all needed. You are needed. We ask you to pick up one of the small napkins and then receive the bread and the juice, the body and blood of Christ, so that we can be nourished to go out into the world. The rails are always open for your prayers. You're welcome to kneel and or stand and pray at the rail. And you're also invited to sing along on the communion hymns if you so choose to do so. that sweet, sweetness, Lord. May it stay in our tongues and in our minds and in our hearts. Help us to know deep within ourselves what a precious gift this remembrance is. These symbols of bread and juice representing so much more for our lives. So help us to hang on to that sweetness and help it to us to nourish us so that we may be your body here on earth until you come again. In Jesus' name, amen.
Please stand for our hymn of dedication. Grace Alone. It's in the black hymnal, 2162, from on the screen. Next week we'll conclude the series. Find a place of resolution, I pray. So, as we end, let's go back to thinking about those annoyances. And I'm sure you've thought of all kinds of them. What kind of small stones are you carrying around? And what small stones are you putting into somebody else's backpack? What kind of medium stones are you carrying?
small and the medium stones, sometimes we don't even acknowledge them because they just come and go. But those large stones, sometimes it takes years and years of forgiveness. And over again, to try to remove them from our own lives. Have we even thought about trying to help somebody else remove the large stone from their life? As brothers and sisters in Christ, that's what we're called to do as the family of God, is to help each other on our journeys. It's a new year. We're into it now, but it's still a new year. It's a great time to start to work in our own lives first, with the small and the medium stones. And yes, we may need a lot of help and a lot longer to remove the large stones. It's a process, but it's a good time to begin working on that process of extending forgiveness and receiving forgiveness. Join me in this little prayer that we'll pray in unison together. Join me. Lord Jesus Christ, Son of God, Savior of the world, have mercy on us. Amen. As we go forth from this place, I pray again that you take with you peace. I hope you can feel that sense of peace and joy from choosing to be here today. I hope you're able to leave feeling more at peace. Receive God's peace, God's shalom.